square and body Chevys. I like square and body Chevys. I like square and body Chevys. It's Shotgun Jay.
I like square body Chevys, but I ain't from the 80s. One day I'll drive a truck, next day a Mercedes. Let that 350 open up, yeah, I'm young, wild, and crazy. Just a backwards lunatic and nobody can save me. I like taking shots because I'm the life of the party. No, I'm not an average Joe, I'm spectacular, gnarly. I like doing donuts in the middle of the road. I'm your redneck's favorite redneck, just thought I would let you know. Bass so loud, I ain't never turning down. Bartender knows the deal, better pour another round. Keep a hog leg in my left hand with a Bud Light in my right. And my shotgun by my side, by my side.
You can find me in a square body Chevy cruising down a back road. Cruising down a back road. In a square body Chevy sitting on 44s. Sitting on 44s. All the country girls wanna ride with me. Cause I'm a crazy wild. Drink a lot. Hand me a Jaeger bomb with a Jack and Coke on the rocks. I'm a young redneck from way out in the sticks. Refer to all of my friends as my skin. If you don't like that, well, I'm sorry for you, buddy. Round here, everybody likes to get a little muddy. I'm in a square body Chevy when I pass by. Black smoke, rolling music, jamming on the Alpine. Light bar so bright that it'll make you go blind. Yee, yee, across my window, now you know that's right. 808s in the mix, I'ma make the earthquake. Backwoods beauty queens twerking on my tailgate.
You can find me in a square body Chevy cruising down a back road. Cruising down a back road. In a square body Chevy sitting on 44s. Sitting on 44s. All the country girls wanna ride with me. Cause I'm a crazy wild white boy. All the country girls wanna ride with me. Cause I'm a crazy wild white boy.
Can take this to the lake and we can play in the mud. I got a case full of beer, yeah, you know we turn up. Hydroponic rolled up, so we bout to burn up. Bow tie on my grill, but I ain't dissing you others. I show respect to my peers, I learned a lot from my mother. I just bought some new tires, you know I learned to burn rubbers. I'm a very vocal hick, when I speak I don't stutter. Country girls love me in every city I go. Got them moving side to side and dropping it down to the flow. Local artists hating on me, but that's just how it goes. I don't pay them no attention, I just let them be.
You can find me in a square body Chevy cruising down a back road. Cruising down a back road. In a square body Chevy sitting on 44s. Sitting on 44s.
Boy in a baseball hat stands in the field with his ball and bat. Says, I am the greatest player of them all. Puts his bat on his shoulder and he tosses up his ball. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down. Swings is bad all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. Now the little boy doesn't say a word. Picks up his ball, he is undeterred. Says, I am the greatest there has ever been. And he grits his teeth and he tries it again. And the ball goes up and the ball comes down. Swings is bad all the way around. The world's so still you can hear the sound. The baseball falls to the ground. He makes no excuses, he shows no fear. He just closes his eyes and listens to the cheers. Little boy, he adjusts his head, picks up his ball, stares at his bat. Says, I am the greatest, the game is on the line. And he gives his all one last time. And the ball goes up like the moon so bright. Swings his bat with all his might. And the world's as still as still can be. And the baseball falls, and that's strike three. Now it's supper time, and his mama calls. Little boy starts home with his bat and ball. Says, I am the greatest, that is a fact. But even I didn't know I could pitch like that. Says, I am the greatest, that is understood. But even I didn't know I could pitch that good.
Just a good old boy, never meaning no harm. Beats all you never saw. Been in trouble with the law since the day they was born. Straightening the curves, yeah. Flattening the hills. Someday the mountain might get up, but the law never will. Making their way the only way they know how. That's just Well, I left Kentucky back in 49 and went to Detroit working on assembly line. The first year they had me putting wheels on Cadillacs. Every day I'd watch them beauties roll by, and sometimes I'd hang my head and cry, 'cause I always wanted me one that was long and black. One day I devised myself a plan that should be the envy of most any man. I'd sneak it out of there in a lunchbox in my hand. Now getting caught meant getting fired, but I figured I'd have it all by the time I retired. I'd have me a car worth at least $100,000. I'd get it one piece at a time, and it wouldn't cost me a dime. You know it's me when I come through your town. I'm gonna ride around in style, I'm gonna drive everybody wild, 'cause I'll have the only one there is around. So the very next day when I punched in with my big lunchbox and with help from my friend, I left that day with a lunchbox full of gears. I've never considered myself a thief, but GM wouldn't miss just one little piece, especially if I strung it out over several years. The first day I got me a fuel pump, and the next day I got me an engine and a trunk. Then I got me a transmission and all the chrome. The little things I could get in my big lunchbox, like nuts and bolts and all four shocks, but the big stuff we snuck out my buddy's mobile home. Now up to now my plan went all right, till we tried to put it all together one night, and that's when we noticed that something was definitely wrong. The transmission was a 53 and the motor turned out to be a 73, and when we tried to put in the bolts all the holes were gone. So we drilled it out so that it would fit, and with a little bit of help from an adapter kit, we had that engine running just like a song. Now the headlights, there was another sight, we had two on the left and one on the right, but when we pulled out the switch all three of them come on. The back end looked kind of funny too, but we put it together, and when we got through, well, that's when we noticed that we only had one tail fin. About that time my wife walked out, and I could see in her eyes that she had her doubts, but she opened the door and said, "Honey, take me for a spin." So we drove uptown just to get the tags, and I headed to ride on down Main Drag. I could hear everybody laughing for blocks around. But up there at the courthouse, they didn't laugh, 'cause to type it up, it took the whole staff, and when they got through, the title weighed 60 pounds. I got it one piece at a time, and it didn't cost me a dime. You'll know it's me when I come through your town. I'm gonna ride around in style, I'm gonna drive everybody wild, 'cause I'll have the only one there is. Yeah, Red Rider, this is the Cottonmouth in the Psycho Billy Cadillac. Come on, Hall. This is the Cottonmouth, and negatory on the cost of this machine there, Red Rider. You might say I went right up to the factory and picked it up. It's cheaper that way. What model is it? Well, it's a 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59 automobile. It's a 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70.
There's a bridge on River Road where I painted my name with a couple of buddies with John Deere spray paint. We used to smoke on the green after the sun hit the hay and made it home by nine, or daddy's temper would blaze. In them high school front doors, shit, we was straight out the back.
Sitting in a distance, chewing red man up by the back. Them straight pipe from the 5-7 made us feel badass. Sitting in the senior parking lot, cranking up Johnny Cash. My grades, they wasn't great, but my heart is nothing but gold. Hospitality's priceless, it ain't about traded a soul. So before you judge my cover, won't you dive in my soul and learn up from another life? I'm like 200 years old.
I miss the old days, Tom Chevrolet. Now I stand up late, swinging on the tailgate. The old days when fist fights were fine, throwing hands didn't land you too much jail time. The
when I show up to a show, everybody knows I'm fucking there. Walk by like I'm stuck in silence, let the folks who camera stare. I'm there to put my county on with muddy water in my veins. Countless nights on Indian Springs, praying I would catch my dream. Off I went to heaven, let me tell ya, I was lost in life. Almost got fronted them pounds to help keep on my family's life. But then I walked to a church in the midst of the night. Put some tears on the tulips and the creation was bright. And I knew at that very moment the fight I was about to pick involved cowboy boots, guitars, and not giving a shit. So let me write to the beat of my two clicking Tony Llamas. Live in a trailer with my family and a few saved up dollars. Church.
Burning your ticket for that long black train. sometimes it is a little hard to get around. But we want to thank you all for coming, and thank you for being here at the church. And let's just start, let's go ahead and have a word of prayer now. Lord, make us know our end and the measure of our days, that we may understand how frail and that we truly are. Your word says, I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And therefore, O Lord, you are our hope. Lord, through all generations, you have been the refuge of man. Before the mountains were created, before you made the earth and the world, you are God without beginning or end. Lord, again, I pray for Cody's family and friends today, and again, I ask that you comfort us in our loss. I also pray that you would give us a deeper understanding of your love, and I pray that this service would be a time of closure for all as we say goodbye to a very special person. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're here this morning to say a last goodbye to Cody. And when we were at the cemetery, if we would have looked around to the different memorial stones, we would have seen that all of them have a date when the person was born, and they have a dash, and then another date that indicates when the person died. That little dash we see between the dates represents the sum total of the life of the person memorialized by the stone. It's amazing to think that a little tiny dash represents the dreams, the successes, the failures, and the hopes of an individual. It's also interesting to realize that no one has any control over the first date, the one when they're born, and they don't get to pick their family, and they don't get to pick which part of the world they're going to live in, or what culture they're born into. And generally, death comes the same way. We don't get to pick out the time or the circumstances that finish our life on this earth. For Cody, it seemed to us that death came way too early. But as I said, we don't get the privilege of picking either the date of our birth or the date we pass away. In between our birth and our death, most of us are faced with many decisions. As a matter of fact, life is a series of choices, and with each of the choices that we make, they're accompanied with its own set of consequences. When a friend or a loved one dies, we are often made aware of the fact that our life is moving ahead to a time when we too will pass. And that makes us aware of the direction that our lives are going, and for many of us, it causes us to contemplate changes we could or should make. This contemplation is good, and it's right, it's part of life. And I think if Cody were here with us this morning, he would have wanted us, his friends and family, to consider these things for ourselves. The biggest problem for mankind has in this day and age is that we try to live our lives independent from God. It's hard to understand because the very nature of God causes him to reach out to us. In Romans 5, 6 through 8, it says, You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Now, don't get offended because the Bible refers to us as ungodly and as sinners. That's what we are. But God accepts us just the way we are, with all our warts and blemishes. We don't usually think of God that way, and yet that's exactly what these verses that I read just said. Well, you've heard enough from me this morning, I'm sure, and you're probably thinking the same thing. But this service is primarily for the family and friends of Cody. That's what we want to do at this time. Most of this time so is now going to be given to you. We want you to have the opportunity to share those memories that are special to you. And this is real important. There's an old saying that a burden shared is a burden halved. And that's true. If you have something heavy on your heart, it's sometimes important to share it with a friend because it makes that burden lighter. In the same way, a memory shared is a memory multiplied. When we share memories and special events and happenings, it causes other memories to come to mind. It might be something that you haven't thought about in years, but a similar event stimulates your thought. And so things go back and memories go back to places in the past. Well, that's what we're hoping for now. These memories that you have will become more precious as you share them with others. And it gives us all a piece of Cody that we can cherish. So that's what we want to do right now. Because this is being videoed, it will be on YouTube. You really need to come up and stand where I'm standing and share from here. But I'd encourage you to do that. If there's something on your heart that you would like to share, some special memory, some special event, this is a really good time to come forward and share that.
Nice to see everybody here. You know, the hardest part about this whole thing is, everybody says, remember, try not to remember the bad things and focus on the good things. But the thing is I never had one bad experience with Cody. You know, it was always, sometimes it get a little scary, especially when he drives. I mean, when he puts his seatbelt on, that's when you really got to worry. But, I learned a lot of good things from Cody and a lot of life lessons and how to have a friend. You know, I'd be stuck in Ontario and about 2 o'clock in the morning. It doesn't matter what time it was. He'd be the first one to answer the phone. And, he'd always show up and, he'd call you dumb and he'd flick you a little bit of crap, but he'd always be there. No matter the time of day, no matter rain or shine, snow or hail, didn't matter. Cody'd always be there. And I'm going to miss him. I think we all are. And, I look around the room and I see a lot of some familiar faces and some unfamiliar faces. And this goes to show that Cody touched a lot of people. And he will be missed. Thank you.
I guess those of you who don't know me, I am Wade Johnson. I was Cody's high school shop teacher. I'm going to do my best to hold it together, I guess. The first memory I had of Cody, he was in junior high. I started out to school, and I drove a school bus. And the first morning, or first couple mornings I was there, I was out front talking to some of the staff. And all of a sudden, the front door of the school ripped open. And one of the employees had Cody basically by his ear. I thought, what's going on? And she throws him down in the yard and says, you can clean your boots off. And Cody was all of 80 pounds, I don't know, 5 feet tall, I guess, but his boots. Huge. I've never seen feet like this on such a small kid. And he's sitting there, you know, looking at her like, what is the big deal? It's just mud. And, you know, well, you walk around the school, and you know everywhere where Cody was. You know what seat he was on the bus, and it could have came from home feeding in the morning. It could have came, the whole school is completely filled with grass, but he found the mud. And it didn't matter whether he was in seventh grade or whether he was a senior in high school. He found it. So, and then as a freshman, he came into the shop, loved every second of it. And I think, I want to say it was in his sophomore year, he was struggling some other classes. And they said, you know, you've got to go in the library, you got to catch up. So I can't remember who it was that was helping at the time. We started talking and said, well, if we just dangle the carrot of shop in front of him, maybe that'll help. And they said, well, Cody, if you catch up on all of your work, he had a mountain of work to catch up on. If you catch up on all your work, you can go out and just hang out in the shop. And his eyes got about that big, and I think in about a week, he was caught up, and he stayed caught up. I think I only saw him miss one of my shop classes in that particular hour, just because he got a little bit behind, but it didn't take him long to catch right back up again. And then every chance he got, he was out in that shop. I think by his junior year, I want to say he was out there for more than half of the day, every day. He found any excuse. It didn't matter whether he was sweeping my floor or whatever. He was there. Quite a few pranks. Some of you back there know. It could have been as innocent as putting a piece of tape over the mouse of my computer and me wanting to throw it against the wall because it didn't work. How many times did he do that? And I consider myself halfway smart, but that didn't make me feel smart because sometimes it took me a couple seconds to realize what was going on. Hiding my coffee cup. Who knows what? You guys could use your imagination and you probably think of it. We took a lot of trips. We crisscrossed Oregon and Idaho several times. And it wasn't just Cody. I think the scariest trip I ever took, there was 8 or 9 of us. And it was just me, 8 or 9 kids and me. And we had Cody, Trevor, Will, just look back in that back row, and a lot of them are right there. Okay, when you're in Portland in a minibus with 9 people who associate with Cody Hall, we have a problem, right? Anything from singing to the top of their lungs out the windows, to making goat noises, to there's some poor unsuspecting towns along Highway 20 that wondered what I think that trip was in a Suburban, why there was a Suburban with yellow publicly owned E-plates sounding like a goat going through all the towns. Finally, about 3 hours into the trip, I pulled the windows up and locked them, and there were little kids. They were just crying because they couldn't roll the windows down. So as the trips went on, we got more and more kids. It's a very, very bad feeling when you're in a Portland mall and from across the way, across the hallway, you hear 9 boys and Cody having the highest pitch voice out of them all yelling, Dad. A lot of times they called me Dad, you know? hi, Dad, you know, and you just want to, come on. So on those trips, though, when it came time to get serious, Cody was the first one to say, okay, we got to get busy. But as soon as that time was up, then jokes were on again. And then one of the last trip memories I have of Cody was we were headed to Portland, and he gets on the minibus with, I want to say, 2 6-packs of energy drinks. It's like, this is for everybody, right? He goes, no, it's just me. All right. Well, and I can't remember if my wife Lindsay was on that trip or not, but we had a girl go a couple times, and she somehow, I don't know, she volunteered to be the female chaperone. And how I'm still married, I don't know, because there was a lot of head shaking going on. But we got to, I said, that's for the whole trip, right? All the way to Portland and back. Cody says, no, these drinks are going to last me till our first stop. And I want to say he went through 8 energy drinks by the time we got to Pendleton. And that bus was rocking. And then he bought another 6-pack there. And when we got to Portland, he bought another 6-pack there. So that was kind of the illustration of some of the trips we took. But in class, Cody had a serious side too. It was far and few between. And a lot of times you couldn't tell if he was actually serious or not. But the shop we had at the school was very, very small, very modest, started from basically nothing. And I could tell he always wanted more, and more and more and more. And his brother going through Vail, you know, that was kind of a hard thing to live up to. And I would look at Cody and some of his classmates there, and I would say, you know what, I'm sorry. You know, I'm trying, I'm doing my best. And Cody would always look at me and say, it's okay, you're doing fine. He goes, I'm happy, all my friends are happy, we're all good. Okay, so we moved on. And then, the year that Cody graduated, we bought a nice new big shop. Had got a bunch of grant money, and Cody showed up for a football game. I think he was watching his girlfriend play volleyball, and he looks over at the shop, looks at me, shakes his head, and I just drop my head, and I go, Cody, I'm sorry. He goes, you know what? He said, you did fine by me. You'll do fine here. It's okay. And he moved on to his other job. He loves that job as far as I know. I talked to him many, many times, and it was always great. He always had something to tell me about, always had a story about what he was doing. And I kind of felt like I was smothering him. I showed up to the shop quite a bit. So I kind of pulled back for a while. And I came back a few times over this last summer, and then I had a part for him to work on. It was like 3 weeks ago. It was the last time I saw him. And he was different this time, very, very different. He didn't make fun of me. There was no jokes. He wanted to show me everything that he's built, everything that he's done. He'd taken me on a tour of that shop, I don't know how many times, but he made sure and showed me everything he was doing again, all the machines and everything. And then it struck me kind of weird, in a retrospect, it's kind of coming back to me, I guess. But instead of telling me to get out or you know, don't let the door hit you on the way out, something of that nature, he looked at me in a very sincere manner and said, please come back soon. Come back and see me soon. And for everybody who knows Cody, that's odd. So anyway, I thought that was a very, very nice last memory. I could tell you stories for ages and ages and ages, but you kind of all get the gist of it. So anyway, I guess that's all I have to say.
So our families have been interconnected for almost 50 years, probably 45 years. I remember Ilena when I was a little girl, showing horses, starting at 8 years old, went through the 4-H horse program and all of the memories that were created and the lessons learned. And then I remember Gina showing horses, and Gina was just a little tiny thing. And I don't know that I've seen very many women ride a horse and stick a horse like Gina did. She was beautiful to watch ride. It was beautiful. She still is. And then we had children, and our children's lives were interconnected. And some of my happiest pictures in my mind of Cody are when he got Jack, because in my mind, in my memory, they just glowed. Jack glowed, and you could see it in the pictures, any pictures with Cody. Jack is just happy. And Cody is just, that's when he lit up the most when I was around him, was that little tiny dog, and that little tiny boy, now when I look at the pictures. And I saw Jack the other day. I didn't know Jack. I didn't know a corgi could get so big. So I told him when I saw him, I said, you know, you have been overly fed on love and time. What a blessed dog. What a blessed boy in that. Alvin and Gina took really good care of their boys, and they provided for those boys. And my children were blessed with hand-me-downs, not just my kids, but my nephews and nieces. Then when Gina had Wranglers, were a good commodity, you know, vests, Carhartt vests. I got other kids, Tucker and Cody outgrew things, and Cody's feet grew faster than Kaysen's feet did. And Gina passed down a pair of really nice quality Justin work boots. And they were, Kaysen was able, I think, to wear them a very short time, and his feet are pretty big too. And I tried them on, and they fit me. And I've worn them ever since. And they had adventures once they got to my house, and they still do. And there's lots of wear left in them. It dawned on me the other day, after I left your house, that I'm still wearing Cody's boots.
I was Cody's fifth grade teacher, and when he walked in the door the very first day of school, he looked at me and he said, Mr. Mack, I hate school. So right then I said, okay, what are we going to do to change that? So we adapted some things, and I knew he kind of struggled with school. So I would wander over to him and say, hey, do you need help? And he'd look at me bluntly and said, I'll be the one asking the questions, you be the one doing the teaching. And I said, okay. One of the compromises we made was that every story he wrote for me had to have Jack in it. If it was Christmas time, Jack had to be a reindeer. If it was Valentine's Day, Jack had to be his date. That was pretty much. But the one activity he admitted to me that he enjoyed was we have an annual Oregon Trail hike, where we have the kids build wagons and hike up the hill to the V, and we reenact the Oregon Trail. and Cody got to be what we called a trailblazer. And he had a stick horse, and he literally ran that whole day. It was about 5 miles. He'd run back and forth telling me what direction we needed to take. He'd be there to mechanic, and it was his thing. Later on, my wife got us some horses. And Gina, out of the kindness of her heart, offered to bring us hay, and Cody was our hay deliverer. And it took us about 10 minutes to get the hay done, and then another hour and a half to solve the world's problems. I remember one time we had an in-depth discussion at how stupid I was for buying a Ford instead of a Chevy pickup. And I would always give him a bad time and say, hey, it's still running, and he goes, keep your fingers crossed. He was like an adopted son to me. I looked forward every month to him coming and us having those discussions. And my wife would peek her head out the window to see if we were okay, because usually those conversations went from 10 minutes to usually a couple hours. When I heard of Cody's accident, like everyone else, I was shocked. Took some time to think. But the one memory that popped in my head is I can see Cody up in heaven, impatiently waiting for his wings. And as soon as he got him, seeing how fast he could make a move so that he could explore. And that was Cody. His feet never touched the ground that I knew of. Even when he was in the classroom, his feet were always moving. And I'm sure he's enjoying that view he's got right now.
I'll try. I work with Alvin. And the first memory I have of Cody is I'm sitting in the shop, and I hear Alvin's truck pulling in, and then the door comes open, and these two little cowboys marching in. And then they got their boots, they got the hats, they got the scarves. And you know, little boys in a shop, we got stuff everywhere, tools everywhere. They're just bouncing off the walls, going every direction. And I asked Alvin, what's going on? He said, well, I think it's bringing my kids to work day. So I don't know if that was true or if Gina need a break. Not sure which. Yep. But anyway, to contain these two boys, we proceeded to find we had a magnet on a little telescoping thing, and I don't know if it's Tucker or us, but we kind of salted underneath the benches and under the shelves and stuff, and this little guy, he was running around, and he'd go find something, and he'd have to come back and show us, and we'd take it off, and he'd go find something else, and then I think he actually found some stuff that we were missing. You just never know. But, you know, I really didn't know him very well. But I know his dad like a brother. And I know he's up there seeking treasure still. And he'll find him.
I'm Wayne Traubert, by the way.
Really want to rush this, so anybody else have anything they'd like to share? Well, let's just go ahead and close our time in prayer then. Lord, Psalm 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Again, Father, I just ask that you would comfort us in our loss. I pray especially for Alvin and Gina. Just make your presence known to them. And I pray for Tucker and Brooks and Alina and Jim. And I just pray that you would just wrap your arms around them at this time. When a loved one passes, there's a vacancy in the heart that just can't be filled. Years will pass. It will not always be so hard. But there's nothing and no person that will ever really fill that void. So, Father, I ask again that you would comfort at this time. We do thank you for Cody. We thank you for the things that he showed us through his life, his fun-loving spirit, his concern for others. We know he wasn't perfect, but none of us are. We thank you for him. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, there's a meal downstairs for you if you'd like to fellowship a little bit downstairs, and you're welcome to stick around. We hope you will, and hope you'll just enjoy each other's fellowship. Sometimes that's the most healing thing that we have in difficult times, is each other. Okay. Well, thank you.